Here's the time cover. This is just
thinking
the unthinkable. It's Time's cover story of March 29th. I believe that America should begin to unilaterally, regardless of what anybody else does, unilaterally diminish its own nuclear military stockpile. If America does that, it will leave itself vulnerable to the communist Russian threat, and we'll all be standing in blood in bread lines because we won't be able to defend ourselves.
We haven't started yet, have we?
We haven't started. Yes, we have. This is it. Are you surprised? This is Dr. Helen Caldicott, President, Physicians for Social Responsibility. You're an Australian-born person, and your whole adult life is now committed to this. I was rather surprised at the response, at the support of unilateral disarmament that's present in this audience.
Well, I think everyone's becoming more and more frightened. They're understanding the medical implications of what it would mean to them if there was a nuclear war and that they would all die. And people actually want to live, and they want their children to live.
All right. Okay. But the way that we ensure their survival is to make sure we're not caught with our nuclear arms down.
Yeah.
No!
Well, that is not how the Pulitzer Prize-winning, Academy Award-winning scriptwriters would have written your first line. But
no, but it got the point across.
Sally Field is a nuclear disarmament supporter. You know her as a woman who has achieved really enormous popular success recently in the entertainment art. Norma Ray. Who would have guessed a film like that would have been the hit? You have our admiration. And lots of other movies. All right. You bring a good deal of power to this thing as a result of your own celebrityhood, and how would you add to what...
Well, let me just tell you why I'm here, really. About a year ago, a friend of mine took me to a place in Beverly Hills where Dr. Caldicott was speaking. I am as apolitical as a human being can be. I must honestly say, even though it's not attractive at all, please, I'm not advocating this, sometimes I don't even vote. I say, what's the point? You know, new people come in and it stays the same, everything will be fine. I met Dr. Caldicott and she spoke and she gave me not a political issue at all, but a human issue having to do with children, the children of the world, and my children, because that's where I live. I have two children that are my whole life, really. Without them, I have no reason. I mean, not that they give me reason to live, but they are my worth. And I got information that I had never heard before, and I became horrified and said, I have to do something. I have to do something. I can no longer be a person who doesn't vote, can be a person who sticks her head in the sand and says, life will go on, they don't need me. I must stand up, and if I have any power to bring Dr. Caldicott to the people to hear this information, I feel that they will feel like I do, and that is that we have to stop this. If they want to have war, they will have war. Let them throw burning oil on each other. That one guy that gets the oil is going to die, and that's real sad. But they won't kill the whole human race.
As a proud graduate of Our Lady of Angels Grammar School in Cleveland, Ohio, I never thought that I would be introducing a Roman Catholic bishop last, but testimony to his own humanity and humility, it is not important to him. But what is important is this issue, and he's already on record about it. He has joined a number of other of his colleagues in the hierarchy of the American and indeed the world Roman Catholic Church. This is the Most Reverend Walter F. Sullivan. You must be impressed by the number of your own colleagues who have really stuck their neck out on this thing.
Oh, something's happening in the Catholic Church. It's amazing. I would say about 20 years ago, we were sort of like a war church in the sense of super patriotism, super military.
Did Cardinal Spellman throw holy water in the helicopters and everything?
Oh, more than that. And he said, my country, right or wrong, if I remember correctly. But what is happening is that individual bishops from their own experiences are beginning to speak out. And I we are sensing the concern of the people of our country of what type of world do we want to live in, and we live a world that's going crazy. I feel it's going demonic in the sense of destruction.
Why is this so controversial then?
It's not controversial. It's the ultimate issue of conservatism and patriotism to want this country to continue, this wonderful democracy. The fact is, if there is a nuclear war, within about half an hour or an hour, many people will be dead, and we think that within a month, up to 90% of Americans will be dead.
Yes, all right. And I know that you can go on and on with horrible statistics, and I believe you. And I think millions of others do as well.
Yeah.
But you have to confront the reality of the fact that there are a significant number of people in this country that believe the inherent horror of nuclear war obliges us to be able to engage in it to prevent it.
Well, I just I just like to say quickly that I think the children understand the truth. I'm a pediatrician and I treat children with a genetic disease and they all die. Children have a sixth sense, and children have said to me, I'm going to die tonight, and they do. And the children feel they're not going to grow up, and they know if you pile more blocks on top of blocks, eventually the pile falls over. I just would like to read something from some high school students that was in the paper yesterday. In the event of nuclear war, the youth of the world have the most to lose. Having no legal power and decisions needed to halt the arms race, we cry out for the right to live our lives in peace without the fear of nuclear annihilation.
Yeah.
In the peace movement, there is a growing conviction that the nuclear weapon will be used. And the conviction is that the arms race, the spiraling, as was said about the building of the blocks, that eventually, either by mistake or by a madman or anyone, and the other issue is that Russia and the United States are not the only enemy, Soviet Union is not the only enemy, that maybe about 10 or 15 countries in the next 5 years will have nuclear armaments.
And to expect, and if we give ourselves the right, and we do, to use nuclear device in the event that we feel our national survival is at stake, think about this. If we think we're going to drop the big one.
First.
Right.
First.
Well, okay, but all right, in any event, that you don't even have to go that far to make this point. This to me is the most frightening reality. It is not realistic to expect all of those other 10 or 15, and they're expecting 20 to have it by the turn of the century, not to, on one occasion or another, use it.
Well, if we
then you throw in a few Idi Amins, and then what do you got?
If we have the right to use it, why doesn't Russia have the right to use it?
I think that if the people of the world, be there from whatever country, are informed, have the kind of information that these people are able to give us on a scientific and medical level, they will have an answer. We have an enormous power as people.
Yes,
a government, they become a mind unto themselves, and they somehow do not represent the people as individuals, whether they're from China or Russia, wherever. Right. If the information is given, there will be a solution, I'm sure of it.
How do you give that information? I think we have a right, as human beings, to really think pretty well of ourselves. I think you're right. I think if we all got together and had a big meeting, everybody'd say, yeah, this is crazy. The problem is that, for example, this is just one example, people of Russia do not have this information.
That's not totally so. Dr. Caldicott has some information on that. Caldicott, take it away.
We have a group called the International Physicians for the Prevention of Nuclear War. You've got to look at me.
All right.
And there are doctors from 30 countries. We're united by the Hippocratic Oath. The largest delegation, except for the United States, comes from Russia, led by Leonard Brezhnev's personal doctor. And we talk about it, there's no politics or propaganda because we're physicians. He went back to the Soviet Union and got on national Soviet TV for 1 hour and told the Russians that they would be vaporized, their eyes would melt, they'd be turned into charcoal, and none of them would survive a nuclear war. Straight medical reporting. There were 40 major articles, front page in the Soviet press, strictly medical reporting. The doctors are telling the Russian people they're not going to survive a nuclear war.
So if that's true, then how come all those old guys are standing on that balcony on May Day with all their badges and buttons and ribbons while these instruments of war parade by, and they're all proud of that?
Well, how come Haig and Weinberger and everyone else do the same thing?
You know, for all our problems, you know, it really looks like Russia is more, if you, you may have trouble dealing with this, I think they're more militaristic than we are.
Do you?
I think they're scary.
Listen,
people.
Phil, America started the nuclear arms race. They made the first A-bombs, they made the first hydrogen bombs, they moved the first missiles, they made the first nuclear submarines.
Okay, but we didn't invade Czechoslovakia, Afghanistan, and all, and the, other stuff.
Well,
please don't miss my point. I don't want to divert what you from what I know is a very serious commitment to you. But unless, as we see this posturing, this military swaggering, that is, I think, at least our civilian guys don't wear those crazy military ribbons. That's not a big thing, but it is an indication that it sounds like we've got a long way to go with those old guys in the Kremlin, long way to go.
But one statistic that really falls in the face of what you're saying, the United States is the largest arms peddler in the world.
True.
And they've got more hydrogen bombs than has Russia. America has 30,000 nuclear weapons and Russia has 20. But I say both superpowers are mirror images of each other. They behave like 9-year-old boys with an arrested emotional development playing in a sandbox. And both superpowers are run by old men, Phil. Old men.
Yes, they are.
And you'd have to say, how many of those old men have actually watched a hydrogen bomb explode and seen a battleship rise up in the water like a splinter and disappear and felt the heat and the blast? How many of those old men have actually witnessed the birth of a baby, a miracle? How many have watched a child die and supported the parents in their grief? And that's where it is. It's human beings. It's every one of us.
And how many of them have stood on the front lines when it got real rough?
Yeah,
they send the young guys to do that.
Yeah, our boys.
Our children! I would like... I'd like to share with you, this is courtesy of NBC News, the reporter is Marvin Kalb, a very thoughtful review of the nuclear circumstances in which we now find ourselves. This will not be fair to this report because we're going to show you just a piece of it. Roll tape. Here's just some sense of where we are.
What was once considered unthinkable, fighting, perhaps surviving a nuclear war, has now become thinkable and altogether frightening.
Winds are 500 miles an hour. The heat is such that most everybody will be either vaporized or killed by third-degree burns.
And so, the remilitarization of America. $1.6 trillion earmarked for national defense over the next 5 years. What we're told is that more weapons buys more security, and more security is the best deterrent against nuclear war. The Soviet Union, hardly indifferent to Pentagon planning, responds by throwing more money into its own military machine. The balance of nuclear terror is raised to new heights of danger. A nuclear emergency, say, in New York City, assuming, of course, as the U.S. does, that there may be a week's notice to begin a mass evacuation of heavily populated areas. Planes will be loaded with outbound traffic. Everyone in line. People heading for the subways. No panic is planned. Even the Staten Island ferry taking city folks upstate. That's the plan, as fireballs, blast waves, radiation fallouts cover the country.
That's just part of a report. Imagine, we aren't fixing the potholes in our streets. We are, you know, to make an absurd observation, but more importantly, we have joblessness. We have people who are, no less a person than His Eminence Cardinal Cook in his speech to the military chaplains vigorously calls for disarmament talks, but suggests, as long as they're underway, in so many words, the military nuclear readiness is a defensible exercise.
Yeah, the big argument, I think, in the church is the whole question of proportionality. And the other question is, can you possess them as long as disarmament talks are going on? My whole position...
Cardinal Cook says yes.
Yes, but my position is I see no sign of disarmament in this country. In fact, I see unilateral armament going on. And that's all... If you have a defense budget, which we just heard about, we're not even thinking in terms of disarmament.
Right.
And therefore, to talk in terms of if, and if, To me, the nuclear weapon is evil in itself, and it's intolerable.
Do you chat with Cardinal Cook at lunch? I mean, do you see him at all?
Well, he's up in New York, and we're down in little old Richmond.
Well, this isn't a frivolous question. I just wonder how much dialogue...
No, I think there's going to be more discussion, and the American bishops are going to come out, hopefully, with a strong statement on the whole question of war and peace, and to try to address the moral issues. My contention is twofold. One is we're not speaking of this from a moral point of view, and secondly, we're not speaking from a faith perspective. I have no interest in the military logic. What does my faith call me to witness to?
Remembering my own theology, when I was in school, St. Thomas was about all we got. He knew everything. If it wasn't in the Summa, it wasn't in any. It wasn't true. Just war. Thomas Aquinas himself.
Yeah, but I think...
Just war, meaning you can engage in it as long as the good that follows from it is greater than the destruction.
Yeah, yeah. Look at that. There will be no good that follows a nuclear war because there will be nothing.
So that Thomas didn't have the benefit of the information about nuclear physics at the time.
That's right. Our knowledge has moved a great deal faster than our emotional development. Our scientific knowledge, we have not caught up as a human race to what our scientific knowledge has ascertained. Right. We are children emotionally still, and we have to grow up some. We have to mature emotionally to be able to handle what we have the knowledge of.
Yeah. See, what is being discussed today is that the just war theory grew out of the failure of Christianity rather than the presence of Christianity. And we have used it to justify killing. And again, you get into the whole question of proportionality and the nuclear question. As Sally said, it's taking it way out of proportion that we need a new thinking, a new attitude.
What would Jesus do if he came back right now?
He'd say, this ain't what I meant. Well, he would use better grammar.
Jesus didn't mean... Jesus said it. It said in the days of old, thou shalt not kill. But I say to you, anyone who hath aught against thy neighbor, leave thy blessing at the altar and go away and fix it. In other words, the instinct behind the kill is anger. And we have to own our dark sides. We can all be as evil as the Nazis. And the enemy image has to be stopped. And we have to say, yes, I'm angry and I'm frightened, but I won't blame you. Now, you know, a few years ago, China, who are still communists, were our worst enemy with Russia. Now, they're best friends. Bloomingdale's is full of Chinese pottery and Chinese silks. They're a great trading partner.
Well, do you remember
trust them.
Remember, from Pearl Harbor to Honda's we've gone. Yeah.
That's right.
It can be done. It really can be done. Mm-hmm. I'm sure of it. If we just change some small ingredient. Not that I am not a person who thinks that people are going to become instantly moral and that they're going to care about mankind. I think that's naive. I think there will always be war. I think people will always be killing each other and hating each other and wanting what the other person has. But there must be a way of getting power another way. Yeah. I mean, power will always be sought, but let's think of a way that it can be not quite so destructive.
Yeah. It sounds to me, though, like it seems that the first thing you've got to do, passionate and truly committed as you are, is begin to change attitude.
Yeah,
that's right.
In this country, attitude.
We have to shatter the psychic numbing.
Okay, now let's talk about the psychic numbing for a moment. I'm coming at you and your beloved industry.
Yeah.
You are not guilty, but you certainly step forward here as a very highly recognized, powerful figure in your own business. Your business celebrates violence.
Yes.
Your business sells R-rated movies of teenagers being slashed in bathrooms.
Absolutely.
To teenagers in drive-in movies.
Absolutely.
You, with all your sophisticated effects, create a movie called Star Wars. It's kind of hard to make this point without sounding a little bit goofy.
I know what you're saying, that advocates
we
war.
Go and we are totally absorbed by this. Now, I'm not saying there should be a law again, but where is the collective responsibility of the creative community in Hollywood to ensure that we get more attractive, positive? I'm not talking about Father Knows Best now. You can even have killings in your movie. But it seems
Thank
to me
you.
That we make it antiseptic.
I know.
And we are raising a generation on these movies. How effective are they going to be in terms of opposing nuclear energy? This is fun out there with all those buttons pushing and firing off. It's fun to do that.
Yeah.
It sure hell beats sitting around the ice cream soda shop with the yellow jalopy. It's more fun to get out there and
Well, I totally agree with you. And as a matter, I mean, I have certainly have no articulate and bright comment on what can be done about that. It brings in money. It brings in money. And ultimately, I think somewhat of that having to do with what we're talking about brings in money. And you will always have people involved in an industry that brings in money, that is just interested in bringing in money. They don't care what damage it does to the people who see the movies. They don't care what damage it does to the people who get hit by the bombs. I there's nothing I can say about that except they're bad people and let's all hate them. But I can't think of anything specifically to stop them. I mean, I personally don't make films like that because I don't like them. I don't want to see them. But there's nothing I can do. I mean, I can't stand in front of the studio and say, don't make that movie. Let's boycott this. We become louder and louder, but it's a very slow rate. Like I say, I'm not any different than the mankind I'm talking about. Our whole industry is very immature. We're making little children movies where, you know, they're all like little porno stick figures, you know, and just walking around thinking of all the no-nos that we can think of. We're children, in a way. We're very, very young human race. And I hope to goodness that we will grow older. But at the same time, we are making movies that count. We are, there are some of us in my industry who have the guts and the knowledge
right.
and the
But for every one adult, for every one adult watching On Golden Pond or Absence of Malice, you've got 25 teenagers watching a low-budget shoot 'em up car chase.
But the question is why?
Why?
My point would be is that because of the nuclear threat, that all of our religious values, the intuitive things that give us value and a sense of future, that is gone.
They're
living under a threat.
The children are watching it as a sort of displacement activity. They're so frightened of nuclear war, they watch Star Wars because they know that can't happen, except that a nuclear war will be a Star Wars, because nuclear bombs are small stars. And it will look like a Star Wars from outer space.
But you know, we've celebrated that kind of activity in this film. We've made it look very
That's right. You know those Atari computer games that kids play with?
Oh, yeah.
They're made by the same company to make computers to fight nuclear war, and the army is pleased because at the moment they get a low level of graduate, low intelligence. They're training a whole generation of kids to handle computers to fight nuclear war.
That's Warner Communications, I think. Of which Atari is a division.
Right.
Warner Communications is not only a conglomerate, but one of the most important entertainment
companies in the world. I mean, my children love these machines. If Eli and Peter were watching right now, they would turn this off and say, they're telling me I can't run my Apple computer or whatever it is. And I think that probably this is so, that what you're saying is so, that in some ways these are supporting a war attitude. But it isn't necessarily so. Computers are also a very productive thing. They can be a useful tool to us,
but
if the people who are running it are people who use that tool only for destruction, that's the point. These are people who are, this is a way of life that thinks only of destruction rather than using scientific knowledge and the newness of things for something productive.
Acting out their fear.
Oh, yeah.
And, you know, an American Psychiatric Association study of 1,000 children in Boston found almost all those children know they're not going to grow up. Why get jobs? Why marry or plan for the future when there is no future? In my kids' high school, there is hardly one student that doesn't smoke pot and drink alcohol, and the psychiatrists think it might be the main reason that they do.
A Doomsville.
Well, I've grown up feeling like this. They're desperate.
Eat, drink, and be
married. Yeah.
Bishop, you wanted to say?
Well, I just said that people keep asking, why is the United States is a violent nation within? And my point would be is the willingness to use the nuclear weapon, that everything else is secondary to that.
I just want to show, we've got a break. Okay, I'm out of here. They're doing it. You got it. Coming at you here in a second. This is a geographic visual which of the continental United States, which on which there are variously colored circles. Huh? I got it here. It's in here. This is real easy. I just hold this up. It's just like old times. Air Force, Navy. These are installations of the Air Force, Navy, Army, as well as ICBM missile base and field locations.
Tell them what ICBM is.
Oh, they know that.
Okay.
All right. Nuclear weapons design and production. So here are. This is where the military hardware exists in the United States, both conventional as well as nuclear, where the missiles are in place for firing and where they make them. And here's how your country looks when you identify all these things on one map.
I'm going to move.
Look where I live.
Yeah, look. Yeah.
Now, to what location do you plan to evacuate when they...
Peoria.
Peoria? You're going to Peoria?
I'm going to the mountains.
the nuclear threat. What do you think? We hope you'll join us.
About a woman. We work with them, touch with them, even talk with them. So hands have to be soft, but never greasy.
Introducing a new Raintree. Raintree Hand and Body Lotion. Natural protein powder makes Raintree feel greaseless, makes hands feel soft instantly.
Softness without greasiness. The feeling's just beautiful.
Try new Raintree Hand and Body Lotion.
Because hands say a lot about a woman.
Those vinegary Johnsons. Sarah, this Cool Whip topping's been in the refrigerator a while. It's still fresh, isn't it?
Of course. Cool Whip's been improved to stay fresh even longer, so the last spoonful's as fresh as the first.
Delicious dessert. The topping tastes fresh.
Yeah, very fresh.
Yeah, fresh as your homemade.
Yep.
New improved Cool Whip stays fresher longer,
so the last spoonful's as fresh as the first.
The furniture district.
Save like never before during our 16-hour sale. January's record cola has forced drastic reductions. Starting tomorrow, you can buy Thomasville, Schwager, Broyhill, and Burlington, Zenith and Quasar TVs, Sanyo video recorders, Magic Chef, Whirlpool, and Westinghouse appliances at unbelievable sale prices. Open an account, use Visa or MasterCard to furnish your home at big savings. But hurry, don't miss district 16-hour sale tomorrow and Sunday only.
Come down to the district, the furniture district. We've really got miles of style.
$3.98 for breakfast.
Breakfast? Who's got time for breakfast?
Now I keep them home for breakfast, and Hostess helps.
Hey, Hostess donuts and honey buns. Mmm.
Powdered donut for me.
Tastes great, huh, that?
And you know, breakfast at home costs about half the price of eating out.
That's important.
So,
keep them home for breakfast.
With Hostess. And save.
When you say we're going to disarm ourselves, how are you going to detect that the other countries have done so too? And leave our country above?
Okay. The SALT II Treaty, which admitted that each side has parity, equal levels of strategic weapons. Hands up those who know what a strategic weapon is. Okay, about 1%. That is very worrying. They're the intercontinental weapons. If you press the button, they take 30 minutes to go from Moscow to or Russia to America. That's why you have 30 to 15 minutes notice before the bomb drops. Now, I've forgotten your question.
We can only detect that they haven't disarmed themselves if they set their bombs off.
There are satellites in the air that can see all the strategic weapons in Russia and in America. That's why they could have a SALT II treaty, because it was adequately verifiable. The Senate had a big investigation on that, and they all agreed. Now, America is going to deploy cruise missiles in Europe. They're small strategic weapons, and they can be hidden. That bypasses SALT II. It's the end of detente, and it's the end of arms control, and it's very serious, and there's been no national debate about
that. Over here, please.
Okay, Sally said that she didn't know a lot of this stuff, and she had heard the doctor here give a speech. What about us? A lot of us haven't heard of it either. How do we get the information?
Well, what kind of information don't you have? That's
I don't know a lot about this nuclear stuff.
You think that this might be just... How do you feel about the dialogue we just...
Okay, I would like to see disarmament, but at the same time, I'm a little worried, because what makes you think if we, you know, stop and disarm... What makes you think the other countries aren't going to come after us?
Well,
that's what worries me.
The point that we're trying to urge in the peace movement, let us begin. Talk about the nuclear freeze. Our country's even against that, of stop building these. The only way to stop is to stop.
We stopped even talking at this point. We're not talking, nobody's taking a first step.
But it's even worse than that. We are penalizing the people who are talking.
Yes.
Bishop Matheson, of Amarillo, Texas, made a statement about whether or not you should work for the Pentax plant and make the new... And they're taking United Fund monies away from the guy.
Yes. Yeah, that's the
well,
bigger...
Okay, so now what? Now, we can sit here all day and say, ain't it awful? How do we speak to
that? See, what you've got to do is, what I'd like to do now is drop a 20-megaton bomb right on this studio and try and break your psychic numbing, okay? 20 megatons is equivalent to 20 million tons of TNT. That's four times the size of all the bombs dropped in the Second World War in one bomb. It'll dig a hole 3/4 of a mile wide and 800 feet deep, turning you, the buildings, and all the earth below to radioactive fallout molecules. Out to radius of 6 miles, every building is flattened. Most people vaporize because we're made of water mostly, and we turn into steam when exposed to the heat of the stars. Out to 20 miles, every person killed or lethally injured. You turn into missiles traveling at 100 miles an hour. Terrible, terrible burns. It takes us 6 months to treat a burnt patient. There are only 1,000 acute burn beds in the whole country. Hundreds of thousands of patients dying of burns. Never seeing a doctor, all the doctors killed or injured, all the hospitals destroyed, no morphine, no pain-relieving drugs. If you're walking 26 miles away, your clothes instantaneously ignite and you become a burning torch. 40 miles away, you look at the bomb, you're instantly blinded. And every town and city is targeted down to a population of 10,000 people or more in this country, we think, and it'll take about an hour to be all over.
Not to mention the cloud that's going to circle the Earth.
Right.
We'll be back in just a moment.
Take a break.
I've got to quit. My stomach.
Stomach? Come with me. This'll help. Maalox Plus tablets. They're great for acid indigestion or heartburn. They even have something for gas.
Tastes good. Smooth, too.
Sure. And Maalox Plus tablets work fast.
Maalox Plus, with the antacid ingredients doctors have recommended most. Smooth, good-tasting, fast-acting.
Families that like chicken like shopping Jewel because they always get fresh, grade A quality and variety. And Jewel chicken is a great family value. Through Wednesday, whole fryers are just 39 cents a pound. And spread the word, Hill Farm butter's on sale. Pick up a pound for $1.69 through Wednesday. Quality and value, there's no doubt about them at Jewel.
We've been a friend of the family for 50 years. Jewel.
Hi, I'm tennis pro Vic Braden inviting you to an unbelievable show. It's the greatest thing I've ever seen. It's the National Sports and Fitness Expo coming to Chicago this weekend at O'Hare Expo Center. Get a load of these celebrities. Rub elbows with Arnold Schwarzenegger, Jazzercise's Judy Shepard Missett, Jack Kramer, Aerobic Dance's Jackie Sorensen, Frank Shorter, Baby Dr. Lyndon Smith, Alan Page, Chicago's Climber Dan, and if you can believe it, there are more. Call 441-7536. You're going to love it.
I love this magazine. It's Woman's World. Every week, Woman's World gives you more of everything. This week, don't miss four fabulous dishes made with cheese. Beauty tips on how to change your hair color in a hurry. There's a fashion story this week on super summer cover-ups. And our travel editor takes you to the Wild West. Plus, much, much more.
Woman's World. Only 75 cents at checkout counters. Get more of everything every week in Woman's World.
Saying what?
I just don't want to sit here and be a sitting target for the Russians. I don't want to use the bomb. I agree with your analysis of what would happen, but I don't want to sit here and let them just walk all over us.
But you see that. I have felt that way, too. That's where I come from. My mother, I love my mother, but she is saying the same thing as you. We have this debate all the time. She says, the Russians will come and get us. They're aggressive people. Look what they've done.
They sure are.
And from my tiny bit of history, I say, yes, it seems to be. But they're mothers and fathers, and they don't want to die. I've talked to people from other countries.
I agree with that, but I don't know what
the answer
is.
They are just as frightened as we are. Their leaders and our leaders have got to come to a point where they can start to discuss.
All right, get
this.
Leaders together,
that's
but we can't
right.
do that.
Right.
We're just ordinary.
No, we're not. We're the people. The people have a voice. We're not just the people.
This
we are it.
That's right. That's
the
very true.
Democracy in the world.
Well, that's it.
You know, this is such a complex issue because you're talking about a dichotomy here of morality versus political reality. Yes, of course, the Russian mothers don't want their children to be incinerated. No one's going to debate the morality of total oblivion of the people of the earth.
But your point is...
But my point is that the Russian people do not vote for their leaders. They don't all get together in the park. They don't all gather in Gorky Park and say, listen...
Yeah, and therefore what?
And therefore, if their leadership is not going to listen to them, it's fine for us to put pressure on our leadership and
so
say...
they can spin off and drop the big one at their will.
Right.
A couple old guys sitting around the table. Can
correct. Decide. I mean, that's
exactly... Right. So therefore, we got to what? Keep
so
these bombs...
So therefore, no one should speak up? So therefore, our power is impotent? You're wrong.
No, our power is not impotent.
We have the ability to change things that are wrong. We cannot...
Our impotence...
That's not the we
comes
are the people
from not
of the
being
world.
Armed.
They don't have a voice.
Okay. They don't what?
You know
they don't want.
They don't have a voice in Russia. They
listen,
can't get up and talk like this
week,
like we
last
do.
Week,
so what should we do?
I don't know.
You don't know.
We have to start.
I want to arm so that we're not sitting
you're
here.
You're armed. You can overkill every Russian human being 40 times, and do you know what? They're the sons and daughters of God. And they can overkill us 20 times.
Phil, the problem is that people think that the nuclear weapons protect us, and they in no way protect us.
Yes.
If we ever use them, it would mean national suicide. It would mean our country
right.
and everything that we hold dear would be gone. There's no protection against a weapon coming in on us. The weapons just take away from everything in our society.
This tax-paying woman, proud American that she is, wants you to know that she's having trouble struggling with her own feeling that to disarm when no one else does is national suicide.
Right. I'm saying,
now what are we going to do with that?
I'm saying we have disarmed by building all these nuclear weapons which cannot be used.
Yeah.
If we ever use them, it means the end of both societies.
End of the world.
We should, if we want to protect ourselves, what we have to do is enter into serious negotiations with the Soviet Union so that we can jointly get rid of the threat of nuclear weapons, which are a greater threat to both of us than the weapons than either country is to the other.
I just want to say, as a teenager, we're sitting here watching these movies, and it's giving us a small scale of what's going to happen, and there's nothing we can do about it.
There is. I said the same thing. This is what I say all the time. What can I do? I'm one little person. Why should I vote? We're what are the people? They don't count. It's those rulers. They're the ones to do it. We must feel that together, if we write letters, if we ask for Dr. Caldicott's information of where we should write, what we should do, how we should start letting our small voices be heard, say it's New York, say it's wherever, say it starts in America, which it does not. We are the last ones to catch up. It's been in Europe for a long time.
The peace movement.
The peace movement has been very loud there, and we are the ignorant ones in actuality.
And we will have Dr. Caldicott's address for all of our viewers,
sure.
those who wish to express
There's
themselves
to
with
be
you.
Done.
And also, you have information about him. We'll be back in
And
just
the
a
other
moment.
Thing is.
I'm sorry, I'll give you two.
If it's really Reed and Barton, it says Reed and Barton. If it's really a Steinway, it says Steinway. If it's really a Levalore blind and not an imitation, it says Levalore. Horizontal or vertical, make sure they say Levalore.
If the Levalore blind, then what do you find? You'll find the Levalore name.
In hundreds of matching colors.
Here at Homemaker's Scientific Sleep Center, we don't have mattress sales. Our prices on famous brands like Sealy and Simmons are so low, we can't have sales. But this weekend, in addition to our low prices, we do have something special. If you buy a Sealy or Simmons mattress and box spring, Homemakers will give you a bed frame free. Just buy any Sealy or Simmons set and get a free bed frame. This weekend at Homemakers, an affiliate of John M. Smith, Woodfield, Downers Grove, and Orland Square.
Honey, Land O'Lakes has come up with a butter idea.
You mean better idea?
No, I mean a butter idea. They call it Country Morning Blend. They blend 40% Land O'Lakes sweet cream butter with pure corn oil. It really tastes like butter.
I told you it was a better idea.
Plus, it has the natural lightness of corn oil.
That sounds better to me.
And it costs less than butter.
It's getting butter all the time. I mean better.
I mean butter. Country Morning Blend. New from Land O'Lakes.
For anyone who's ever been a waitress, for anyone who's ever been a customer, for everyone who wants a king-size portion of hot entertainment. Ladies in Waiting, the new hit musical at the Civic Theater.
Are you ready to order?
If there's one job I hate, it's scrubbing the toilet. And you know what? I don't do it anymore. There's this different kind of chemical system. 2,000 flushes. Keeps the water crystal clear. Keeps the bowl sparkling clean continuously for about 4 months. No rings, no streaks, no stains. Just put the container in your tank and forget it. Every time you flush, the chlorine crystals dissolve away rust and minerals before dirt rings and stains appear. 2,000 flushes keeps the bowl so sparkling clean, I don't scrub at all. And flushing sure beats brushing.
Action for nuclear action for nuclear disarmament is located at 56 North Beacon Street, Watertown, Mass. The zip is 02172. If you don't have a pencil, I'll be happy to show it to you later. This is Dr. Caldicott's professional address. What do you get when you write to you, besides a horrible scenario of what might happen?
Well, you can find out what you can do in every area of the country. Physicians for Social Responsibility have 101 chapters. We will dispense a doctor at any hour of the day and night as if you were having a baby to come and talk to you about the medical effects of nuclear war to your churches, peace groups, businessmen's organizations. We've got films called The Last Epidemic. Very powerful. You saw shots from that on the screen just now. Slideshows, books. You can read my book called Nuclear Madness, What You Can Do by Bantam. It's in the bookshops. There are lots of things to be done. We'll help you right into there and join.
I believe a positive attitude is contagious. If we believe we can change it, we'll make others believe we can change it.
Yeah.
Well, I was just thinking, what difference does it make if we disarm and Russia doesn't? Once they push the button, we're gone anyway. And like this lady said, maybe if we start, the other nations will follow.
That's good.
I just want to say, I thank God I live in a country that I can speak against something I don't approve. And because I'm not worried about myself, children, grandchildren, and great-grandchildren, I want to know what to do so that I can speak out.
Yes. Trust the Russians every minute. We trust them every minute not to press the button. Do you know we've placed this great democracy in their hands? It's not up to us whether we live or die. It's up to them, and they're frightened. How do you handle paranoid patients? You don't make them more frightened. You have to produce conflict resolution and understand how they think. That's what we've got to do.
Right on.
Deal with them.
I hear lots of...
trade with them.
We all have so many fears, and what you're saying is let's turn our fears into action and let people hear from us. And there are groups that help us do that. There's a national group, Clergy and Laity Concerned. There's your group, and it's, you know, in the place where I live in Oak Park here in Chicago, we've already passed a nuclear freeze, and they've done it in Evanston. We can do it all over.
I was just wondering how much impact the petitions are going to have for disarmament that we're signing in our churches, like the state of Vermont. How much impact will that have?
Yeah, let's get that on the... Boy, Vermont made a strong statement.
And so did New Hampshire. 5 out of 6 towns voted for the freeze. That's a bilateral cessation of production and development of nuclear weapons. Kennedy and Hatfield have put it in the House. 170 congressmen have voted for it. That's 1/4 of the House of the Congress.
Yeah, but the sad thing is our president and Alexandra Haig have spoken out against it.
That's right.
Already to try to undercut it, that effort.
You said something about the peace movement being dead in the United States, except for this. And what bothers me about all this is it's easy to be against murder and rape and everything, but a lot of people that were against Vietnam went back into their closets after Vietnam was over. And what about all the support for the peace movement that has gone on all these years? That when this gets solved, are all you people going to go back in the closet?
Yeah, but the peace movement is very much alive. One of the interesting things. Oh, well,
it is. There's a revolution in thought occurring. It's very exciting.
They were saying that how we can't trust Russia. We can't even trust our own government. Brezhnev just proposed that they wanted to cut back military supplies in Europe, And Reagan won't even sit down and talk to him. Him and Haig just think it's a joke. I think we got to discuss these problems before they get any seriously.
Yeah. I was just wondering where the doctor got her information.
Yeah, where did you, in your own information, as a pediatrician, I assume you were exposed to?
Well, there are government documents. Most of our material comes from the Pentagon government documents. For instance, there's a book called The Effects of Nuclear War put out by the Pentagon. It works out how far into human flesh a piece of glass will go traveling at 100 miles an hour. It's full of stuff like that. It's like a recipe for annihilation. Yeah. You can get it from your government.
That's great that we keep hearing how horrible it's going to be if it happens, but what is that doing to take care of the problem? We keep hearing if we have nuclear war, everybody's going to be dead. Well, what are we going to do to prevent that, though?
Okay, the starting point is to change our whole attitude towards peacemaking and to begin...
How are we going to stay a peaceable country, though? How are we going to stay peaceful?
I don't think we are a peaceable country. You say, how do we stay that? We have the arms in Central America. We don't want to arm El Salvador to the teeth. People in that country are dying.
That kind of death is okay.
Who said it's okay?
Sally Field says it's okay to...
No, she's saying we would be... She's saying, look, if two macho guys want to have a duel and shoot each other, she said it's sad.
That's a very bad thing. But I'm not naive enough to think that I'm going to sit here and change that one iota. What I'm saying is let us take the tools away from them that are going to annihilate everything else around them.
That you're taking the tools away from our country, and you know,
I'm not saying our country. You keep saying that as if I'm saying let's take all these weapons away from our country. I'm saying let's bilaterally discontinue this kind of development across the board, every single country.
We'll still have enough.
Let's decide to stop. Yeah. Then let's decide to start.
Yeah. How many years are we talking about?
Well, I think you see, we've got a terminally ill planet. Infected with lethal microbes which are metastasizing rapidly. We have an acute clinical emergency. We have to get rid of every single nuclear weapon within the next 5 years. That's what I think.
Yeah.
And we'll be back in just a moment. Once more, Dr. Caldicott's address is Action for Nuclear Disarmament, 56 North Beacon Street, Watertown, Massachusetts. The zip is 02172. And let's get, incidentally, the information you'll get includes, she's not pretending to make you a PhD in nuclear physics, but this is an organization which has been formed by physicians, real, live, duly authorized.
No. This is women and men. This is the lay group. We prescribe the therapy, and the therapy is to get involved in Action for Nuclear Disarmament. Physicians for Social Responsibility tell you how awful it is, and then for therapy, you start working. It makes you feel better. We're organizing a Mother's Day march on May the 9th all over the country. There's a march in Chicago on April 10th. Yeah. And the special session for nuclear disarmament is June 12th. All sorts of things are happening. Start working. It makes you feel terribly joyous.
Neil, this should get in, too. A lot of people are. There are increasing numbers of people who have finally said no longer life as usual, I'm going to get to do so.
Right.
And you know what's interesting about this? The women are leading this.
The women are. Do you know why? Because we have the babies. And once you've had a baby, I would die to save my baby. And that's the most powerful instinct anyone has. I want my children to grow up and sort of Sally.
All right, this all is wonderful, but I really don't feel we have that much effect. Therefore, I think we should arm.
Don't say that.
We have to protect ourselves.
We have to fight. This is the ultimate question. This is it. If you say that, it is, that is a cancerous statement to me.
True, but if the rest of the world isn't following, we cannot sit back.
Why don't you just try? Just write one letter and see if it has any effect. Tell one neighbor, one friend, and see if it has an effect. It doesn't hurt. It can't hurt, you know.
You've got to pressure your congressmen and senators to, you know, Washington's still fairly asleep. Let them know that you want your kids to grow up. Do you know, it's probable if we continue doing nothing, we're practicing passive suicide, and it's possible within the next 10 years we'll all disappear. The whole of life on Earth, God's creation.
We're there to protect ourselves.
You don't protect yourselves with nuclear weapons.
You do.
That's suicide.
It keeps things level.
No,
oh, my goodness. I mean, that's... The threat of an error alone, even if everyone was sane and said, we'll never push this button, we decided we'll have these nuclear weapons, it'll keep everybody straight, the percentage, the whatever it is, the possibility for error is enormous, that no one need push it at all.
You know, someone plugged a War Games tape into the fail-safe computer in the Pentagon in November 79. It made an error. The whole world went on nuclear alert for 6 minutes. At the 7th, the president was to be officially notified. They couldn't find him. There were weapons heading towards Russia. We were 14 minutes from annihilation by error. And that was front page in the London papers and back page in the New York Times.
When can we stop stockpiling?
Well, this is the problem. The leaders have to really agree to all this.
Well, the leaders
have to protect ourselves. We are. We're living in a world of military arms.
Yes, that's their point.
So holler about it. Say something.
Please.
Yeah, sir. Yeah. I think two things. First of all, I'm sad because the question is a me question. It's not they.
That's
it's what
right.
am I going to be and what I'm going to do, number one. Number two, it saddens me after seeing a movie last night called Missing, which our State Department didn't want to have, that our government has been proven to be dishonest with us in Chile, in El Salvador, and in so many places. When are we going to get leaders who are honest?
One thing I think everybody's been asking what you can do. There is a walk on April 10th, and I would like everybody to come to the
Chicago,
end the arms race and save the human
That's
race.
In Chicago.
It's a matter of shame.
Yes, ma'am, with so little time.
Yes. I've spent most of my life raising 5 children. When the youngest of my children says to me, is it worth my going to school? Is it worth my trying? Shouldn't I just go and have fun and just have a good time? Why should I bother to try to get really good grades and do... Well, the whole point of the matter is that I, as a mother, feel responsible for preserving some of life for my children. And that's why I'm going to be involved and I'm going to demonstrate
on
it.
This is the ultimate parenting issue.
Besides letting each other know our concerns, we need to let God know our concerns. The power of prayer is far more powerful.
Sorry.
As a pediatrician, I want to know how you feel. Aren't we teaching our children kind of a double thing, be peaceable, and yet all these Atari games are all aggressive and war and this?
And the children are so frightened, they just don't know what to do. This is the ultimate issue of preventive medicine and the ultimate parenting issue and the ultimate religious issue. What is our responsibility to God to continue his evolution?
Over here, please.
With your petitions and your demonstrations, do you hope to affect legislation that the people of this country, well, we're already as a nation behind the Equal Rights Amendment, we can't get that in, so how do you think that the majority of the people
against nuclear war will
listen to us? They must listen, but they will not respond to the majority.
We don't know. You have to try.
Darling, I can't see you.
It took 30 years for us to get voters' rights clearly stated, and we got to keep trying.
And we'll be back in just a moment. Yes.
I would just like to say that people who are out marching for peace and teaching their children fear and not to want to live, who's going to run the country in 20 years when these children don't know how to handle things?
You mean this would teach them fear, this position?
Yeah, their fear, they don't want to live.
No, we're not teaching fear. We're teaching that there is a way to handle power productively, that we all hold a certain amount of power that can be productive and healthy, and not to be frightened of but to take it in your hands.
The doctor mentioned that there are children, 90% or some figure that she gave, who are on drugs or drinking.
As a result,
services provided and promotional fees paid by the following.